My name is Brian Isaacs and I'm principal of South Peninsula High School in Deep River, Cape Town. I've been principal since 1984, July 1984, and I just finished 30 years of being the principal at this institution. This was a school for so-called colored children, and we use the term so-called because of the apartheid system. And in 1967, we had the Group Areas Act that said that the so-called coloureds must move out of the area. And there are about 300 homes here in this area, which was built by the city council for the people who came back from war. And these people then had to leave these council homes. Some of the council homes were broken down to make way for development for so-called white people. And the community was very traumatized by this. As you can imagine, if you live in an area for 20, 30 years and now you must move, this creates a tremendous amount of trauma. They also wanted to move the school. And the teachers here fought very hard to keep the school as a beacon of light, to tell people who are out there who were forced to move out that one day you will come back to the school, you will come back to the area. And of course, when we had our new government in 1994, people could then, through the land claimants, actually come back into the area. And the school welcomed people back. And the people who, the so-called whites that were, you know, given land in Constantia and who got into these council homes, they made no effort to welcome people back. And today we still have problems with so-called white communities who don't accept us as being part of this community. For example, they will complain about the public address system which disturbs their peace. They've now recently complained about the buses that bring our students in, and there's a historic reason for that, because we used to get students from the area, but because they were moved out, they are now traveling from Lavender Hill, Zikuvlei, Retreat, Grassy Park, Witten, Lansdowne, Khayelitsha, Mandalay. Some students came from Simonstown. Some students came from Paul, some students came from Stellenbosch to be here at the school. And the school is very proud that we remained here and that we could welcome, after the new government liberated South Africa, we could then come back to our roots here. The challenges that we face as a school, yeah, as all schools face, is we have shown that we're an excellent school, but because they don't believe in our school, they will walk right past the school and they will not send their children here. And this is what we still have in South Africa, that we don't have a situation where people have confidence in our schools. When the moment they see, oh, it's a black school, they must not be then producing good work. And only so-called white schools will produce good work. And that's the mentality that we have to break down. And the only way in which we can break it down is where we constantly produce good results and we constantly show people that we are prepared to share and to care in our area. If they don't want to share and they don't want to care, they are making a choice there. But we certainly would encourage, in a community like this, where you have a mainly so-called white community and then you have a pocket of so-called coloureds, And then you have a small group of people coming from, you know, Khayelitsha and Guguletu and Ayanga to the school, that schools in South Africa, you know, must maintain standards, and we must change the mindset of people. We got 100% pass rate last year. We believe that, and we had an 85% exemption rate, bachelor's pass. And we encourage our students, this year we would like to see 90% of our students at our school getting a bachelor's pass. There's an interesting thing about a dropout rate. If you can look at the entire South Africa, they will say to us that a million students enters grade one and only 500,000 leave grade 12. And then they say they're worried about the other 500,000. Now, when we look at the number of primary schools to high schools, for every two primary schools, there's only one high school in the country. Now, there's your answer. That's why students are falling out. It's not because they don't want to go to school. There's not enough high schools in South Africa. So those children just don't go to school. So it's not about the fact that children don't want to go to school or the teachers are not doing their work. There's just not enough high schools. And that is why half, 50% of the children fall out. It's as simple as that. And, you know, government sometimes, because they feel dejected that they've tried their best and people are still criticizing them. But our country must have the political will to say, that's the problem. How do we fix it? And not try and say, no, but you know, the children, we're going to try and find out where these children are. Children are not there because they couldn't get into high school. And so we try at our school is to say to our students, when you enter grade 8, we want to see all of you in grade 12. So we don't have a high dropout rate because we encourage the students. We don't encourage them to leave grade 9. We say to them, you're too young to make a decision to go to a further education and training college. And also, we don't want to make a decision for you to cut your career short where you could go to a university. We're not going to label you that you are never going to get into a university. We are saying to you, we will prepare you for a university. And if you don't want to go to university and you want to go to a FET college, by all means do so. If you want to go and work, by all means do so. But I'm not going to decide for another person's child that at grade 9 level you must leave school. All schools experience various degrees of gangsterism, whether they are rich schools or whether they are poor schools. All schools will experience drugs. All schools will experience students who are ill-disciplined. And sometimes what the media does is something happens at the school and then they want to shame the school. And I think you need to look at in context, in what caused that particular thing to happen. And if I always say, when you want to change schools, you must know the history of that school. And then you can begin to change the school. But you can't just go into the school, ignore the history and trying to change the school. You're not going to be very successful. So I would say we all experience it. And we all have to do something about it. I'm not going to say at our school, you know, we have no gangsterism. We have no drugs. We're dealing with issues where youngsters have been caught with drugs. And we must deal with it, because it's happening out there in the society also. We're dealing with students who are ill-disciplined, but we're dealing with it. We're not ignoring it. And where we have youngsters who showing signs of gangsterism, we will also, as part of our duty as teachers, I always say that we can never as teachers say that we don't want to become social workers. We don't want to attend to the emotional needs of students. We don't want to attend to the physical and mental needs. We have to. You can't just say it's not just a 9-to-5 job. where you switch yourself off from the community. You're going to have to be, that is what teachers have to do in any country to build up a country. We find ourselves in quintile 5, which is the richest quintile. And when the quintile system came out, they then took schools and they looked at the socioeconomic area in which they found themselves. And so because we find ourselves in Constantia, and although our students don't come from Constantia, we were placed in the rich school category. And we've always been fighting this. And we feel that there must be another way in which you can resource schools. Now, my personal belief is that we should just have one system of schooling, and that's the government schooling. You should close down all private schools. All schools should have the same number of teachers. You should, if people earn above a certain salary level, they should be taxed, an educational tax, and that money be used to improve education. Because if we're going to continue this way of charging school fees, already there's animosity between the poorest schools and the rich schools. And this animosity is going to build up. It's going to build up all the time. It's going to lead to a lot of problems in South African society. Because the people who are able to get into those rich schools, they do have more resources, they do have more teachers, therefore they are going to be more successful academically. They might not be successful politically because they don't know the needs of the poor. But academically, they will take up positions in industry and even in politics at the expense of the poor people. So unless our government has the will to close down these private schools, to take over the private schools, and that stupid parents can then really send their children to a school of their choice. Because now you can send your child to the school of your choice, but you pay for it. So if I want to send my child to Bishops, I can send my child to Bishops, but I'll have to find 40,000 rand a year to send my child there. And the poor parents, they have their dignity. And so they're not going to say, I want my child to go to Bishops, because they know they can't afford it. So what are they going to do? They're going to send their child to the school in the area. And perhaps no school fees are paid there. But they're not going to get all those resources. And that's the problem facing government. Do you have the political will to say to these people, the rich people, we're going to close these institutions? Now, yes. You know, principals in South Africa have a terrible history. We were a divided country. We had 18 different education departments. The department put in people and into principal posts who agreed with them. So especially in the so-called black educational system, they wouldn't put in progressive people, people who spoke out against them. And most teachers in the 1960s and 70s were removed from their posts who were progressive. And so who took over were people who were on the side of the apartheid government. And so they weren't necessarily the most intelligent people who took over schools. And they suppressed excellence in the schools. And now our government is dealing with this issue. You have people in positions, they're not doing their work. Now what do you do? So we have to face up to hard facts. You know, if a person is not performing, and the historical reasons for that, then we must correct that. Then we must say to the principal, you have 2 years in which to show that you can run the school, and we will help you. And if you don't, unfortunately, we're going to have to demote you, for example. And because if you have a bad principal at the school, The poor children who are coming there year in and year out are experiencing the same problems year in and year out. So we must have the political will to change that situation. And coming back to the principals organization, the principals were always seen on the part of the apartheid government. The present situation is, and this is my personal opinion, that also what happened in the new South Africa was the South African Democratic Teachers Union. I also belonged to them at one stage. I was also part of that formation. Then came a strike here in the 1990s. And we went on strike. And then was the whole question of you had to submit your leave forms because you were on strike. And the direction from SATU was you don't fill it in. Make it difficult for the department to know who was on strike. And my attitude was, but I mean, if you go on strike, then you're prepared to sacrifice your salary. And I was prepared to sacrifice my salary. Then what is the use of going on strike? If you know you can go on strike, but you're still going to get paid, then what's the purpose of striking? And I then resigned from SATU, and I joined a what is the Teachers League of South Africa, started in 1913, and what I thought was a very progressive organization. And then in 1998 we formed